Hey, Kim, what's happening? Hey, what do we got on the old inbox today?
I don't know. Let's take a look. So we have a question from a scientist trying to figure out if a water-wettable column will allow them to retain polar compounds.
You know, if you think about it, kind of seems to make sense. I mean, we're talking about reverse phase chromatography.
Yep.
And in reverse phase, we know that water is the weaker solvent, so you would expect everything to be retained. Mm-hmm. So I think it makes sense that being 100% aqueous compatible would give you higher retention.
Yeah, it could. I mean, there are a lot of water-wettable columns out there, but are they all going to help you retain polar compounds?
Yeah. The key here is the polar compounds, because as we know, retaining polar compounds on a non-polar surface,
that's tough.
That's kind of the hard part. Well, there's only one thing we can do.
I know. Let's test it. All right, Jonathan, what should we do?
All right, I got a couple great ideas. So what I think we should do is grab a bunch of C18 reverse phase columns. That's where we should start. What we'll do, we'll fire them up on the old LC here.
Okay.
First, what we'll do is we'll take the columns and we'll condition them or wet the phase in 100% organic. We'll use acetonitrile. Makes sense. Then what we'll do is during the run, we'll swap that mobile phase over to 100% aqueous, and we'll do some injection of some polar compound. Mm-hmm. Maybe we'll use something like thiamine or thiourea.
Okay.
We'll figure it out. Mm-hmm. Then what we'll do is we'll stop the flow on that column. And what'll end up happening is that the mobile phase in the pores, being that it's 100% aqueous and doesn't want to be in that hydrophobic pore, will expel or actually push out of the pore.
Mm-hmm.
Then what we can do is another quick injection, again, of the same polar compound, and we can track any loss in retention from when the phase was wetted and when it was de-wetted.
Okay, we have some data. Let's take a look.
Wow, okay, great. So it looks like we ran 5 columns here, all C18s. And boy, we got some really interesting results. So if we take a look at actually some of the data here, notice first that like the black line here indicates the initial retention of the phases when they were wetted. And the dotted red line that's shown afterwards is how much retention that phase had lost in that 100% aqueous mobile phase.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at all the columns we have some columns that didn't really lose any retention in the 100% aqueous. But as you can see, we have some that lost quite a bit.
So there's
a wide range of overall wettability, so to say, with the columns that we looked at.
So let's look at the retention.
Yeah, it's really interesting here. Since this myth is really all about polar analyte retention and not so much 100% aqueous compatibility, what you can really see here is that for some of the phases, even though they're fairly aqueous compatible, they don't really have a lot of overall retentivity. And you can really see that on the chromatogram at the bottom. It doesn't lose a lot of retention, so it's definitely a water-wettable phase. But look, the retention's just terrible for that polar analyte. All right, Kim, there's some real data that really supports what's going on with these columns. If you look at these two graphs here that I'm showing, what you'll see is as you increase the pore diameter of the phase and decrease the C18 coverage, what you can do is you can really make that phase wettable. Increasing the pore diameter actually increases the contact angle, which allows aqueous mobile phase to actually flow more freely into the pore. And obviously having a less hydrophobic phase, so lower C18, also is advantageous to allow that hydrophilic or water to come into the pore. So there's some real science behind what's going on here.
So since this question is really about how do I retain the polars, what's gonna work? How do they do it?
So let's take a look at this graphic. So here I'm showing just kind of a surface image of a C18 phase, one that's got a lower ligand density, so not a maximum coverage. And what's going on here is that with a polar analyte, you still want those non-polar parts of that molecule to interact with that hydrophobic C18 chain. You still want that. But what you also want is to promote the secondary interactions via hydrogen bonding and or ion exchange with the residual surface silanols on the surface. So what you do is you put down less C18 coverage, you don't sterically hinder the surface, and now that polar analyte can kind of work its way down in there and kind of interact. So that'll actually promote secondary interactions and hence more retention.
So the real key then to polar retention is not so much water wettability, it's the ability for that polar compound to be able to interact with the stationary phase.
Exactly right. And when we talk about retention, boy, you got to remember other things such as phase ratio and the overall retentivity of the phase itself.
Okay, so coming back to this question, this scientist wanted to know if 100% aqueous compatible columns would let them retain polar compounds.
Mm-hmm.
How do we want to call this?
Jeez, Kim, this is 100% busted.
Exactly.
I mean, when it comes to using 100% aqueous mobile phase, that does not translate into polar analyte retention. As we've shown with our experiments, what you need are the secondary interactions with the residual surface silanols. Mm-hmm. You need a lower C18 ligand density to achieve this. And you also need a particle that has overall higher retentivity in general. 100% water wettable doesn't mean anything for polar analyte retention.
Agreed.
It's just a tool to use, just a tool.
It's a lot more complicated than that.
Exactly right.
If you'd like your question to be answered on a future episode, please feel free to email us at trustyoursciencewaters.com.